morning. Welcome home. Welcome to Asbury Memorial, and Happy New Year. If you would please start the red pads down the aisle there. They'll be in the chair in front of you. Put your name in there and your email address if you'd like to be in on the emails here. It's a great way to keep up with the circle of life here at Asbury. If you plan to attend Asbury on a regular basis, if you are a visitor, we'd like to get you a name tag. There's a small whiteboard in the breezeway there. If you put your name on there, a name tag will be provided. It's the first Sunday of the month, so we have our large coffee hour in the social hall immediately after the service. It's a great time of food and fellowship and an extension of our worship period here this morning, so just follow everyone down to the social hall. If you want to learn more about our programs here at Asbury, in the social hall during the coffee hour, there is the Connection Corner, and the folks there will be more than happy to answer all your questions. After the coffee hour at 1:15 here in the sanctuary, Reconciling Ministries will be having a meeting. They're going to discuss the general conference that's coming up shortly. I hope everyone has enjoyed our wonderful Christmas decorations, but it's now time for them to come down. That will happen at 6 o'clock this evening, and all help would be greatly appreciated. We have started a new year, of course, and so we have a new flower calendar in the corner there in the narthex. So if you'd like to sign up to have flowers here at the service, you can do that on the board. The cost of the flowers is $60. If you're looking for a church home, of course, we'd love to have you here at Asbury. We have classes 3 times a year. Next classes are this month on the 20th and 27th. Lunch is provided by the church and our fabulous hospitality team. If you'd like to participate, you can talk to the folks in the Connection Corner or give them a call in the church office. We hope you read our monthly newsletter. Lots of good information in there, prayer list and otherwise. If you don't have access to the internet, there are hard copies in the narthex. At this time, if you would please double check, make sure your cell phone is turned off so we're not disturbed during the service. I'm trying to make sure. I felt like I missed something, but I don't guess I have. Thanks so much for being with us this morning. We hope you have a meaningful worship experience.
A star shining brightly in the east,
discovered by those who have eyes to see the unusual and the challenging.
A journey into unknown territory,
taken by those who have courage and curiosity.
The Holy One recognized in spite of humble origins,
worshipped by those who have wisdom.
Thank you. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people in Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I might also go and pay him homage." When they heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that had been rising at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. And on entering the house, they said the child with Mary, with his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. And then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please join me now as we pray together the prayer printed in your bulletin. When we have seen the challenging star, yet have failed to set out on the journey, God of all hope, forgive us and give us strength. When we have encountered the forces of evil and have compromised and gone along, God of conscience, forgive us and give us courage. When we have known worth and goodness, yet fail to give the support of our best gifts, God of love, forgive us and give us a generous spirit. The God of light, love, and peace be with you.
Let us now worship God with our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you. So before we sing our offer anthem this morning, there's a part we're going to do that you get to participate in. And we're going to create the rain forest here in the sanctuary. And we need your help with that. There are four moves that you'll have to do, and the moves are just simply rubbing your hands together for your practice. Very good. The second one is snapping if you can't. The third one is patting your leg. The fourth one is helping your feet. So for this to work effectively, it has to be done in silence. Okay? So what I will do is I'll start here with the choir. Barbara Daniel are back with us, and she's a solo this morning. And I will start, and I will just simply stand here, and I will hand doing motions with you. And when I am facing in your direction, you will start the motion that I do. So when I get here, the balcony is with us. So it's the balcony all the way across. And you continue with those motions until I get around with the next motion. Okay? If at some point I should stop and I'm asking you to do this, do it louder. And then we'll go through the whole cycle and create the rainstorm here into the sanctuary. And then after when we're done, please remain in silence and the choir will start their anthem.
bless these gifts that we bring today and bless us as kingdom builders here on earth as in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stop by the Connection Corner today or in the next Sundays and add the cities, states, and countries where you have lived or studied or worked or served so that we may find additional connections to each other. Hope you do that. Chris, I think, mentioned the flower calendar, that we start a new year, and this is a beautiful, wonderful way to remember and honor our loved ones. And so the calendar is back in the narthex. Be sure to sign that up for that for a significant date that you might want to have. We haven't forgotten about our Wednesday night suppers. They will begin again, but I think their starting date is February 13th. I just wanted you to know that is in the future, Wednesday night suppers. And then Chris mentioned the new members class. I look forward to being with those of you who are considering being part of this congregation, and so we start in two weeks from today. An email I just got last night, the women's group will be meeting again. They will meet the next four Thursday evenings in January for a four-part series on the Advent theme, words of hope, peace, joy, and love. That's at 7 o'clock, from 7 o'clock to 8:30 in the conference room here on the first floor. And please feel free to invite a friend. Gloria Moses, I think you're back there somewhere. Gloria, please stand up. Gloria started at Asbury Memorial in 1931. As a toddler, was here. As a youth, then she moved away for 37 years. And now is back for her golden years. Well, this Tuesday, Gloria turns 89. So we want to wish her a happy birthday. And Gabe Beauchamp. Gloria, if you'll keep standing, where is Gabe? I know he's here somewhere. Gabe, there he is. Come, can you stand in the center so we can see you better? There you go, buddy boy. Gabe also has Gloria's birthday. He turns not 89, but 9 on Tuesday. Let's sing happy birthday to these wonderful people. As you know, it's been said that things come in threes, and so 2 weeks ago we all said we hope you have a Merry Christmas, and then last Sunday we said have a Happy New Year, and today we say have an ecstatic epiphany. Have an ecstatic epiphany. Why? You'll find out in a minute. You see, the reason we're still singing Christmas carols and the reason we still have our decorations up until this evening when we all help to put them up, the reason we're not like Walmart, which puts away Christmas items and then rushes in hearts and candies for Valentine's the day after Christmas, is because the season of Christmas goes to today, January 6th. Everyone's familiar with the song, The 12 Days of Christmas. Some of us may think the song's about the 12 days before Christmas because we hear about the number of shopping days left to Christmas. But the song is about Christmas Day and the days that follow it that lead to Epiphany, January 6th. Epiphany has a signature story, just as the Christmas story. The Christmas signature story, of course, is in the Gospel of Luke. It's when the birth of the baby Jesus happens in the manger and the shepherds come to worship him. That's in Luke. The signature story for Epiphany is in the Gospel of Matthew. It's the story of the Magi, the wise men who traveled afar to see the Christ child. So whenever you see nativity scenes with shepherds and magi gathered together at a manger, that kind of didn't happen. The Magi arrived much later. They come sometime before Jesus turns 2 years old, and they come not to a manger, but to a home. We don't know how many Magi there were. Tradition tells us three. We sing We Three Kings. But that number is because there were three types of gifts mentioned: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But the Bible doesn't tell us how many Magi were on this journey together. The word Epiphany means manifestation, discovery. Something hidden has been revealed. It's from a Greek word that means to show or to appear. And the English word cellophane is derived from it, because what's underneath can be seen. The overriding message of the Epiphany story is that God has made an appearance. That, of course, in itself is pretty special. But what makes this appearance especially special is that it's an appearance to Gentiles. The Magi are Gentile. The shepherds, remember, in Luke's gospel were Jews. Mary and Joseph were Jews. The story of the Magi was important to our ancient ancestors because it let people know that God came to connect with everyone, with all people. Now that may sound like old news to you and me, but it was extraordinary to the people of the early church. Christianity grew out of Judaism. The first Christians were Jews. In fact, we're not even sure Jesus planned to start a new religion. He just wanted to make things a little different from Judaism. And at first, these Jews who were following Jesus, they did not encourage Gentiles to join them in following Christ. There were many debates and arguments about whether Gentiles should be included. But part of the Epiphany, part of the discovery here, is that God is for everyone. And how timely a message for us as United Methodists, as our denomination is about to debate and vote about the same issue next month at our general conference. And so for the early church, Epiphany was as big a deal, if not bigger, than Christmas. We don't think of it that way because we just assume Gentiles can be followers of Christ. But it wasn't always like that. Gentiles are the majority of followers of Christ now, but at that time, Gentiles were the minority. They were outsiders looking in. They were excluded. And if you fell on the side of not allowing Gentiles to be part of the way, as the early church was called, then you probably loved Luke's version of the birth story with Jewish shepherds finding the Christ child. But if you were in favor of allowing Gentiles to participate, then you probably said, but remember Matthew's version. Remember Matthew's story. It talks about the Magi. The Gentiles discovered the Messiah too. The Gentiles worshiped him too. And so it's a story that should be told year after year. For the writer of the Gospel of Matthew introduces Jesus by way of a story that shatters religious tradition and brings strangers, outsiders, into the spotlight. It's right there at the beginning of the Jesus story. And before this story is over, Jesus will shatter all of the old boundaries of religion and race and social class and status and gender. Before this story is over, all of the outsiders, the marginal, the unclean, the lepers, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the poor people, the women, the children, foreigners, Roman centurions, all of them outsiders will become part of his story, will be welcomed and included in his company, be welcomed at his table. Before it is over, Jesus will scandalize the most pious Orthodox religious leaders by his radical inclusivity. He doesn't know an outsider. He apparently doesn't understand that one of the functions of religion is to define the tribe, draw lines between us and them, and then to build separation walls of doctrine and practice to keep us away from them, keep them out. He doesn't understand that way of thinking at all. He tears down the walls, crosses the boundaries, flings the doors wide open, and welcomes everyone home, and it begins here. Epiphany with the Magi. That's why we can be ecstatic, folks. Because if this hadn't happened, maybe you and I couldn't be at a place like we are today. It's important to understand the significance, because we're supposed to do the same thing. We're supposed to follow Christ. We're supposed to have a church, a table, a heart that includes and welcomes everyone, and we will always strive to do that at Asbury Memorial, and I hope we strive to do it as we go out into the world also. One of the other epiphanies that Matthew wants his readers to have is to realize that this child is the long-awaited Messiah that was proclaimed by the prophets of old. You see, Matthew knows his Hebrew Bible backwards and forwards, and he's able to use the ancient text to shape his story so that this message can be made clear that this is the Messiah. He knows that the 60th chapter of Isaiah proclaims that leaders from all over the world, foreigners, will come bearing treasures of the earth to the Lord of Lords. Isaiah says that these foreigners will bring gold and incense. Sound familiar? And so Matthew has his foreign leaders bringing gold and frankincense to the Christ child. But Matthew mentions a third gift, one that is not mentioned in Isaiah, the extra gift he includes, the one not mentioned in Isaiah, is myrrh. Perhaps at the time of Matthew's writing, the myrrh trade in the Near East was at its peak. Myrrh was often used in conjunction with frankincense, so maybe Matthew simply felt obligated to bring his gospel up to date culturally. But I wonder if Matthew may have mentioned the myrrh for another reason. At that time, myrrh was a balm, a funeral balm, an ointment put on the body after someone died. Remember, after Jesus was crucified, Nicodemus brings myrrh to anoint the crucified body. Why would Matthew introduce a substance associated with the embalming of bodies into the story of a child's birth? Maybe he wants his readers to realize that there is at least one way in which this Messiah is different from the Messiahs talked about by many of the prophets. Perhaps Matthew wants his readers to know precisely what they are in for if they venture any further into his text. This Messiah is not one who will rule the earthly world. This is not a Messiah who will use force and violence to achieve power. No, this Messiah, this Christ child, will grow up and will suffer pain, persecution, and death. Shakespeare said, the play's the thing. And I think what Matthew is trying to say to us in this story is the myrrh's the thing. The myrrh lets us know that this Messiah is like no other. The myrrh reveals a God who is willing to suffer in solidarity with humanity. This Creator is willing to take on the form of a vulnerable child, thus becoming one with all humanity and creation. And so, like the Magi, we set about on a journey of faith in this season. And as we journey, we remember the third gift. We remember that no matter what we face, no matter what struggles we go through, we have a God who understands us, who understands our pain and our suffering, a God who walks with us, a God who is not judging us, but a God who has empathy and loves us and cares and who will help us overcome any difficulties, even death. A God who resurrects from the dead and a God who always offers us new life. Always. That's why we should be ecstatic. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. Sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain. But then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded oh, there is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. Amen. Amen. Will you turn with me in your bulletin to the Liturgy for Holy Communion? This is God's table open to all people. If you would like to receive communion, just come forward using the center aisle as the ushers assist you. We will partake by intinction, by dipping the bread into the common cup. All of the bread is gluten-free. After receiving the elements, please feel free to spend time at the altar in prayer. If you are simply unable to come forward, but would like to receive the elements, simply inform an usher. We will be glad to bring the elements to you. The choir will go first today because they want to sing for you as you receive communion, and also those who are serving us at our big coffee hour. So after Reverend Marich leads us in the invitation for communion, will our choir come forward.
We give you thanks and praise, O God, because you are forever working to draw us close to you. In order to better connect with us, you created a unique moment in time. You used the stars of your creation and imagination to mark the tiny village of Bethlehem as the birthplace of a new relationship with us. In the itchy straws of our humble reality, you come to us in human form as a small, defenseless child. And so, with all your people on earth and in heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Jesus Christ, whom you have sent to us, O God. The Magi followed his star to pay him homage. The apostles heard his call and followed him. The crowds ate his bread and received his healing. Wise people everywhere live by his teachings. On the night in which he gave himself up, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ has come again.
hunger and thirst, God says. If you hunger and thirst, God says.
Thanksgiving. We give thanks to God for the meal God has provided, reminding us of God's love and faithfulness. Now let us go from this church as those who have seen the Bethlehem star. We will follow our most cherished dream and bring it to reality. We will give our most precious gifts to advance the way of Jesus Christ. We will resist the Herods of our time who seek to delay and to sabotage. In the light of the Bethlehem star, life changes. The way ahead shines with opportunity. Choices appear and decisions are clear before us. We will let the light of the star illumine our lifestyle, flood our spirits, and enliven our faith community. Return joyfully to your home and proclaim by word and deed that God is alive, God is present, and God cares. Amen.
Thank you.
say a word of welcome back to Danny and Barb Beam, if you heard a familiar voice during communion. I'm so glad they are now back with us. Thank you for being part of this faith community, and those of you who are visiting, welcome. You are part of us too. We're just glad you're here, and we ask God now to bless us as we leave this place. May we look for the epiphanies. May we look for ways God is showing up in our lives, in the world, and may God show up in us. In the name of God, the Creator, in Christ the Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit.